Hi everybody, welcome back. In this video, let's talk about the prep work that's needed to do the analysis of variance. And keep in mind, when we compute an analysis of variance, we compute an F value, it's an F ratio. What we're gonna need to do is work on what we call an ANOVA summary table. Some people will call it a source table. Sometimes I use both terms. And you can see there's really quite a bit that we need to compute in order to get to F. There are actually 9 different things we need to compute, and I know that seems somewhat overwhelming, but it's not at all. In fact, you're going to see very quickly, once we start computing ANOVA, that things move along very smoothly. And keep this in mind as well, because this will help you understand things as we move along. This is analysis of variance. Variance is not a new concept for us. We're just talking about how much things vary. And specifically, in this source table, we're going to be computing variance between the groups. That's what the BW stands for. That's one source of variation. And then we'll also be computing variance within the groups. So how much people differ just based on their personal individual differences. So let's just make sense of these columns real quickly. SS, of course, is going to stand for sum of squares. So we have one formula that will compute sum of squares between the groups. Degrees of freedom is pretty obvious. And now you probably recall by now that variance is simply computed by taking sum of squares and dividing by degrees of freedom. That's exactly what we're doing right here. But that column is labeled mean square because that's just the terminology that's used. Mean square equals variance. They are exactly the same thing. In fact, if you think about it, just look at that formula. We're essentially taking the average of the sum of squares, the mean of the sum of squares. So mean square or mean sum of square is the exact same thing as variance. So look down here now. Here's another source of variation. Remember, with ANOVA, we are partitioning variability, partitioning it in terms of variability between the groups and variability within the groups. So here's a formula that we use for overall variability within the groups. Here's the degrees of freedom. And we simply take sum of squares divided by degrees of freedom to find variance within the groups, or mean square within the groups. So once we have the variance between the groups and the variance within the groups, we can take the variance between the groups, divide by the variance within the groups, and that is our F ratio. So as I mentioned to you before, we're trying to figure out, do we have quite a bit more variability between the groups above and beyond the variability within the groups? If we do have quite a bit of variability between the groups, then we're going to have a relatively large F value. And of course, if we have a relatively large F value, we'll have more of a chance to reject the null hypothesis and say that statistically significant differences between the groups exist. But if the variability between the groups is about the same as the variability within the groups, our F ratio will be relatively small. It'll be relatively close to 1. And then we won't have much evidence that there are differences between the groups. And any differences we see between the groups are likely simply due to chance. So these are all the formulas we're going to need. And as you know, before I start jumping into the 4 steps, in this case for ANOVA, I like to do some prep work. I like to get all the numbers that I'm going to need. And that's what this next sheet is about. Now, your sheet doesn't have everything computed. I've given you a sheet of solutions where you can see this already computed for you. But what I recommend that you do is, just like in class, you work on this as I show you what I've done, because that way you're gonna learn it better. So let me show you my technique. I'd be looking at a formula sheet to look at the formulas that I need in order to ultimately get that F ratio. And I'd start asking myself, what do I need and what do I have? So let's look over here again at just our data. So again, we're looking at a research study where we have people in a cold room, in a comfortable room, and in a hot room. And we're trying to see if the temperature of the room affects how much they can learn. And then we can see here, here's a measurement from 5 different people, 2, 4, 5 different people, to see how much they've learned. So they've been given some type of a memory test to see how much they recall from what they were just taught. And when we just look at the numbers, we can see that the people in the comfortable room, in general, it looks like they're remembering more information than the people in the hot room. And, you know, we can look at these means that I've computed right here. The means back up what I just said. It kind of looks like people who are in the comfortable room are learning more than people in the hot room and the cold room. But we need to determine, is that the type of difference between groups that we would expect just by chance? If it is, then chance is a good explanation for the differences we see. So what we're going to do is partition the variability. We're going to look at the variability between the groups right here, the variability between these means. So that's this measurement right here, variance between the groups. And then we're also going to look at the overall variability within the groups. So the variability that we see within the data right here, the variability that we see within the data right here, and the variability that we see within the data right here. So that's this right here. That's the variance within the groups. And then we will compute our F ratio. Do we have more variability between the groups than we do overall within the groups? That's what we're trying to find. All right, so let's look at our formulas. In order to compute variability between the groups, I will need to compute variance between the groups, mean square between the groups. So I need to compute sum of squares between the groups. So you'll see there's some new notation here. It says I need T values. What's a T value? T just represents a total for this group. So just add it up. And these numbers are really easy to do in your head. So most of those I will just simply do in my head. When we need a calculator, I'll pull out the calculator. But 0 and 1 is 1, 4, 5. So the total for this group is 5. So T sub 1. So the total for group 1 right here. We'll call the cold room group 1, comfortable room group 2, hot room group 3. So the total for group 1 is 5. So that's all that the totals are. So I want to go through and make sure I've got all my totals. Total for this group, let's see, 7, 13, 16, 20. Total for this group is 5. All right, so those are the T values. I go right back and I look at my formula. I'm going to need to know this small n. There's a distinction between the small n and the large n. Small n just represents the number of people in a group. So in this group, I've got 5 people. In this group, I've got 5 people. And in this group, I've got 5 people. So I note all of my small n's. Another thing I'm going to need is a G value. What's G? G just stands for the grand total. So you see, there are some new symbols that we need to get used to with ANOVA. They're usually really straightforward. It's no big deal. Pretty easy to remember. T total, G grand total. So the grand total is just the grand total across all the groups. So if I take this total, and add this total, I find that 5 and 20 and 5 is 30. So G, the grand total, I'll just list off the side, equals 30. What else do I need? I need to know this large N. Well, that's the overall number of people. If I've got 5 people in this group, 5 people in this group, and 5 people in this group, my overall N across the entire study is 15. Let's go down. It says I also need to know the sum of the sum of squares for each group. So the overall sum of squares for each group is simply found by combining the sum of squares within each individual group. So in other words, we're going to need to compute sum of squares for each group. Let's go ahead and do that now. So I've done this for the first group so that you can see and just remind yourself what I've done. Remember, sum of squares we've been computing since, I don't know, the second week, the third week. You just need to look at a formula sheet to remind yourself how to do it. But by now, that should not be a problem for you. We essentially compute some form of sum of squares almost every single day in class. So just look at a formula and figure it out. In this case, I would see this formula right here. I need the sum of x squared minus the sum of x, that quantity squared, over n. So you might recognize that as the computational formula for sum of squares. And it really makes most sense to be using the computational formula because it's simply easier to compute. That's why we call it the computational formula. So for that, it says I need squared x values. So right next to my x values right here, like for this group, I just made a column and I put it in red so it would stand out so you would see. And I'm just going to square every value. So 0 squared is 0, 1 squared is 1, 3 squared is 9, 1 squared is 1, 0 squared is 0. I already know the sum of x. I'm going to need that in my formula because that's just this total right here. And I also need the sum of x squared in this formula. 1 and 9 is 10, plus 1 is 11. So we're dealing with simple numbers, which is good, because then you can understand theoretically what we're doing, and we're not getting tripped up with the math. So let's just walk through it real quickly, so you can see where I got this value 6 for sum of squares. So sum of x squared, we already said that equals 11. So right there, I've got 11 minus, in the numerator, I need the sum of x, that quantity squared. Well, the sum of x is 5, that quantity squared would be 25, divided by n. and equals 5 for that group. So ultimately, then I have 11 minus, I made a typo here. It should be 11 minus 5, because of course, 25 divided by 5 equals 5. So 11 minus 5, go ahead and fix that in your handout. 11 minus 5 equals 6. All right, and that's where I got that value. So you'll need to do that for group 2 and for group 3, and just as easily, you'll find sum of squares. Back to our table. We're trying to figure out the information we need. We're trying to do the prep work that we're going to need for ANOVA. All right, well, this formula says we need the sum of x squared, and that refers to all of our data, all of this original data. So just kind of don't look right now at the red numbers that I've got in there. All of the original data. I'm going to need to square every value and then add them up. So off to the side, what I recommend that you do is just write in the squared values, kind of like I did in red. So I've already got that done for that first group. And let's just pull out the calculator and we'll do this together. So I'm just going to square every value and add them up. I've got the squared values already listed for the first group. Let's just add them as we go. 0 plus 1 plus 9 plus 1 plus, now I'm just going to move over here. I'm going to square them in my head, but just add them up as I go. So we've got plus 16 plus 9 plus 36 plus 9 plus 16. Of course, you can work these out with me as you go. Plus 1 plus, that should be 4, plus 2 squared is 4. Equals 106. So that's where I got this value right here. Sum of x squared is 106. You see, nothing that we're doing is difficult. There's just kind of a lot that we need to do. It's no problem. It's all very straightforward. Right here, we need the grand total squared. We already had to find the grand total before. We've got it. We wrote that in. It equals 30. We just took 5 plus 20 plus 5 equals 30. All right, let's go up to the next column. What else do we need? That's what we're trying to do, figure out what we need to compute the ANOVA. K represents the number of groups that we have. So draw a little arrow to that and define it for yourself. K equals the number of groups that we have. We have 1, 2, 3 different groups that we're comparing. So off to the side, I put K equals 3. Degrees of freedom within groups, N minus K, that's the big N. The overall N, we know, is just simply the number of people we have overall. 5, 10, 15, and we wrote that out. K, we already figured out. Big N minus 1 is degrees of freedom total overall. We already know what the overall N is. That's 15, so we have it. And now at this point, everything that we need to compute the F ratio is already within this table. So we would use sum of squares between groups and degrees of freedom to compute mean square between groups. We would use sum of squares within groups and degrees of freedom within groups to compute mean square within groups. So we're done with all of our prep work. So make sure that you've got this page completely filled in. You understand how to do each of the calculations. If you have any questions, of course, you just want to let me know. In our next video, we'll look at the F distribution. We'll make sure we understand it. We'll make sure we understand how to find a critical value. We'll make sure we understand how to look up that critical value in a table. And then we'll be all ready to compute our first analysis of variance. And it's way fun. You're going to love it. I will talk to you soon. Take care.